education organization. We're based in Washington, D.C. And many of you know about this program, and some of you have been on this program. Raise your hand if you've been to D.C. on Book Show. We got a couple. See some familiar faces. So when you come to D.C., we teach you about government and civics and how to be more active and engaged in your government in our nation's capital. This program is a little bit different. We're really going to focus on Guam-specific issues this week. And that's really what I'm looking forward to, is to learn what's happening in your own community and to see all of you develop ways that you can address these issues and present these to your legislature. And it's going to be a really exciting week. I'm looking forward to working with each one of you. And that's my intro.
If you want to go ahead and tell the speaker we're ready, when she's ready.
I'll tell you who I am. My name is Paul Bernico. I've worked with Close-Up since 1997, and I will keep telling you about me and the Close-Up program until Speaker Judith wants to have walked the room and I'm going to be quiet. First thing that I want to say is please recognize that your legislature has done an incredible thing here for these 3 days. They have opened up the legislative space, this meeting room, for you to do this work, which I think nothing speaks more clearly about their commitment to hearing your voice than their invitation to you all and us to come here and do this in this room. So whenever you see a member of the legislature, and you're about to see one in a second, please say thank you for this opportunity. This is really incredible. We have never had the opportunity to do a youth summit inside the actual legislature anywhere we've done the youth summit, and we've done them everywhere. So having said that, Speaker, if you'd like to speak to your students.
Is, in fact, a close-up alum. I hear you came twice.
91, 92?
Yeah, not because I was a king.
The minute I heard that, I was like ecstatic, because we'd love to find out when former close-up students take positions in their government. It's just great to hear, it's great to love to hear that. And if you want to come up and say hello to the speakers, I would love to shake your hand.
Can't stop talking just by can't stop.
So you didn't hear it from me first. We do. We believe that, for all intents and purposes, you're adults, which means that you are already citizens. Now, you have to think for a moment about what we mean when we talk about citizenship and democracy, because that's not the same as citizenship in any other kind of system. It's actually much harder. It's more difficult. If you were a citizen in a kingdom or a dictatorship, your job would be simple. Listen to what they're telling you to do, do it. In a democracy, your responsibility, your role as a citizen, Bill Clinton said that is the highest office in a democracy is that of a citizen. And so one of the things that I want to tell you right up front is that we believe completely, because history shows it and current events show it. If you look anywhere around the world or in past U.S. history or in world history, you will see repeatedly the same pattern. Wherever there is a successful struggle for justice, for dignity, for democracy, it's not led by old people. It's led by young people. Young people are the leaders that make the changes that have to happen. And anytime you see young people starting to turn away from the political system or from political involvement and say, you know what, if they don't listen, it's not important, I got other things to do, I'd rather watch video, I'd rather play with my friends, which is fine, all of that has to happen, you're young. But when all of that takes place and you do not see any point or purpose in your involvement in the political issues of your day, that place, wherever you live, is dying. Its democracy is dying because it needs your leadership. So one of the things that you will hear a lot from other places, you won't hear it from John and I, is this idea that you are the leaders of tomorrow. I'm telling you, carry around a pocket full of rocks, and anytime somebody tells you you're the leader of tomorrow, you throw a rock right at your head. Why? Because it says something about what you are today. If somebody tells you you're a leader tomorrow, what do they say about today? This is where you start speaking up. What are they saying about today?
They're not a leader?
That you are apparently not a leader today. Your time will come, but it's not now. And I'm telling you, your time is now. Your community needs your leadership. You are a valuable and irreplaceable resource for leadership in your community. And this isn't just in Guam, this is everywhere. And you look at what's happening in what's called Arab Spring, that's young people. That's young people changing the world in the Middle East. And it's just been that way everywhere, all throughout history. And so that's the first message of today. And the second message of today is get ready to start speaking up, because we are going to be really asking you to speak to each other and with each other about the issues that you are concerned about. We're going to move through sort of an overview of the program. I understand that Congresswoman Bordeaux is going to come and speak, and when she does, we'll sort of suspend wherever we are at that point. But I want to go ahead and get started giving you kind of overview of what the program is going to look like. Is that okay again? And then we'll just sort of interrupt it as we have to make other things work. Okay? So, welcome. Okay, so we're just going to quickly talk through, I don't want to go moment by moment through the schedule. I just want to give you the big picture outline of what's going to happen. This morning, we are going to do a little bit of an icebreaker so that you all can get to know each other. In fact, you know what? We should probably do that now. Let's do an icebreaker. So I'll tell you what. This is going to get you up out of your seats, get you moving around. And by the way, when I say meeting people, include in the meeting of people me, John, and anybody else that happens to be in the room. So on the back of your first welcome page, you will see a thing called Human Bingo. Everybody know how to play bingo?
Yes.
Okay. So your job is to walk around. Don't go to the people you already know. Otherwise, you're defeating the whole point of this. Go to people you have not yet met and find out if you can fill in one of the cells with the information you gather from that. Okay? Write down their name in the cell that matches what they do or have or something about them. And the first person who gets bingo, either straight across the way, straight across this way, or down the center.
I'm sorry to interrupt, but before you do your icebreaker and go on with your program, the speaker and I and other members of the legislature will be jumping in and out. We're told to leave you guys alone so we can brainstorm without any undue pressures. But I understand at the end of your summit, you'll be making a formal presentation to the legislature. Number one. Number two, based on what you just said, I thought you mentioned that the legislature has adopted by policy that the youth of Guam are the leaders of today and tomorrow. And so that's in line with that.
Thank you.
What's your name?
Jurassic.
Okay, so we had our first bingo. Jurassic got bingo. Keep going. And there's bonus points if you fill in all of the boxes. Okay, Jeremy just got bingo.
Oh, you got bingo too.
Okay, so Whitney has spoken directly to a government official. Carla also got bingo. So TR enjoys reading. Is it
initial?
Do you know who it is?
Yes.
Oh, what's the name?
Which one?
This one.
Jobel.
And
that
then
one is Gerald.
Gerald traveled to DC.
That's Mark.
Mark has two brothers. Oh, got it. And Brianna. And you are?
Roscoe
has bingo. Is it this way? And what's your name?
Selena.
Selena has bingo. Chelsea. Chelsea also has bingo. Uh-oh. Which way? Diana. Oh.
Donna.
Donna?
Dinah. It's like Anna with D.
Oh, Dana. Dana has bingo. What's your name, hon? Rochelle has bingo. Yeah. Jelen has bingo and Bing has bingo.
Can I speak on this thing?
No, not yet. Later.
No, to ask someone if they have two brothers and sisters.
Oh, all right, Hank.
So can I put your name down? What's your name?
Jobel. Jobel has bingo.
Yes. Bingo.
Hang on. Which way? This way? Jenica has bingo. Yes. Good. Mark. Mark has bingo. Austin.
Well,
Austin has bingo.
I just realized I have bingo.
Oh, okay. Good. Wait. Nice. Wait a minute. Okay, do you actually know all these people now?
I tried to.
Boom has bingo. Yeah, it is. Now it is.
I bingo.
Okay, I'm going to call you Boom now.
Well, you have a lot.
Rechlin has bingo.
Hi.
Verlene has bingo.
What's your name?
Brian has bingo. Thank you for circling it. Where is it? Eduardo has bingo. Oh, I don't know. I'll come back around that way. Charlene has bingo. Which way? This way? Brittany has bingo. Whitney has bingo. Rowan has bingo.
Bingo again, sir.
This way. Can't see your name. Ben. Ben. Thanks, man. Ben has bingo. Mark, you got bingo again?
Yes.
Mark has bingo round two. Jesse also has bingo. Natasha has bingo. Lorraine has bingo. Melanie has bingo. Archie has bingo. Brianna, which way? This way? Oh, well, I actually got it twice then. Yeah.
Oh, my gosh. I didn't even know.
Brianna has double bingo. Which way? Erickson has bingo. What is it?
Isa
has bingo. Joseph, which way?
Bingo there.
And bingo here?
Oh, and bingo
there. Joseph has double bingo. Which way? Oh, actually, you got it twice. Yeah. Imani has double bingo. Mark with a C has bingo. Not to be confused with Mark with a K. Okay, at this point, if you already have bingo or double bingo, go ahead and take a seat. Go ahead, sit down. Okay, raise your hand. If you don't have bingo yet, come on up here. Come here. Here. Okay.
What do you need help with?
Okay, so which one are you looking for?
Watches and use daily.
Okay.
Ask. Ask.
Okay.
What's your name?
Mariel.
Okay. Mariel needs some help, so you guys pay attention for a second.
Does anybody watch the news daily?
I saw him back there.
Oh,
there.
But I go to the same school as them.
I watch the news daily.
Okay.
Any help? Which one?
Marielle has bingo. Yay! Okay, what are you looking for?
Anyone has two brothers and sisters?
Austin, what's your name?
Mark.
We got three Marks? Raise your hand if you're a Mark. Yeah, okay, so, really? Okay, so Mark number three has bingo.
Janessa needs help.
What do you got, Vanessa?
Janessa.
Same shoe size?
Tell them.
Same shoe size? Nine.
Oh, there you go. Just put down Mark, because you're likely to get one of them.
And what's your name again, hon?
Janessa has bingo.
All right. So having played bingo,
and here's what I recommend.
how the legislative process too long works. Okay, you guys, it's good to know that you guys looked that up publicly. Okay, and then the U.S. government, and actually, you'll see, go ahead. The legislative process, if you've done the legislative process in the United States Congress, legislatures everywhere, it's always the same basic idea of how they do the process. So, what's step one in the process?
An idea.
All right? Nothing happens unless somebody is looking out at the world and trying to identify what are the conditions that we're living with, what needs to be improved or addressed in some way, and therefore, one of the ways that can be addressed is by making a law. Now, where do these ideas come from? The people, okay? Does that mean, let's see. Yeah. So, does that mean Jurassa sits down, thinks up an idea, and goes and stands before the legislature and says, I propose the bill? Well, I'll tell you why not. Because only a legislator can propose a bill. No one, not even the governor, can come in this room and say, I have here a bill that I would like the legislature to examine and pass. It doesn't work that way. Only legislators can propose bills. So if Janessa wants, did I say it wrong? If Jurassa wants some idea to become a law, she's got to get a hold of a legislator. And she's got to say, hey, this is my idea for a law. Now, here in Guam, you also have a few Congress, so that's another route that you can take to get something proposed into law. But you can also go directly to your legislator with your ideas for what law. Now, I won't answer the question. Most often, it's not an individual citizen. It does happen that an individual citizen notices something in the community and says, there needs to be a law. Or they notice a law that just doesn't work properly. Or they see a law that they just think is flat and fair. And they sit down and they write a letter to a member and they send it in that way. But the more common way is for citizens, ordinary citizens who are not members of the government, who have some sort of organized common interest. So for instance, a group of businessmen, and particularly, group of businessmen who are in the same kind of business, so a group of hotel operators, they would have interest in the various laws that regulate the business that they do, and so they would collectively get together as an association or an organization and say, here, we have an idea about laws that would improve our ability to do hotel operations. Now, at the same time they're doing that, there might be other organized citizens who don't necessarily agree with what the hotel operators want to do. They may have a different idea of what they want, and it might be at odds. But if that other group just sits around and doesn't do anything, and doesn't propose or counter-propose their own idea, then chances are pretty good that since the hotel owners are the only ones giving voice to what they need, the hotel owners are likely to get a law passed. So citizens oftentimes organize into groups in order to propose ideas
wait time. This is what we do when we're just going to wait until somebody gets courageous. Was that Kennedy?
Well, first let me say good morning, half a day.
Good
morning. Oh, we're all awake, huh? And I have a few members of my staff with me, and I just wanted to introduce them to you. A couple come from Washington, D.C. Daniel, right here. Daniel Walls, and he's in charge of natural resources, education, health issues. So he's been with my office for a number of years. And back over there, right there, is Adam Carbolito. And Adam, most of these, all of these staffers are college graduates. Adam just finished school at Notre Dame, and he's now the press officer in Washington, D.C. And then over there in the back are two of my valuable employees from the district office, Mr. Keen Paris, the man with the gray hair. He's the policy advisor, and I think he has his gray hair because working for me is not easy. Now, next to him is a very young gentleman, John Kelvo, and he joined our staff. He's the assistant policy advisor, so he's picking up on everything we do, and believe me, it's not easy working for a congressional office. So first of all, I'd just like to say good morning to all of you. And you know, I'm very familiar with the close-up program because many of you travel to Washington, D.C. How many of you have been to D.C.? You've been to my office? Yes, okay. Well, I wanted to just go into that a little bit. Whenever the close-up students are in Washington, they call up my scheduler. And there's normally a time that you have a schedule in Washington, and then you set up a certain time where you can visit your members of Congress. So these young people come to see me, and we have a photo taken, and then it's developed, and you take that with you. And then normally there's probably about 15 of you or so together. Sometimes you come just a couple or three. And then we take you to a special room there, and we do a little quiz. Did you go through that? Yeah. My chief of staff, Mr. Witt, makes up a few questions. And they're interesting questions, believe me. They're about politics in Washington, who are the leaders and so forth, and what's being discussed on the floor at the time that they're there. And then after that, we have a winner, right? Isn't that the way it goes? And after that, we have pizza. We serve the pizza to, did you have pizza? Oh my gosh. Well, you'll have to come back. But normally that's what we do. If the schedule, is open and we can do that. But we love to have the students come. And what amazes me is that you're all so independent. Some of you travel by yourselves even, or whatever. But most of the larger groups, we do have the quizzes, and then we take you to lunch. So I wanted to get that out of the way. Now, the next 3 days are going to be very important to all of you, because you're going to be given the experience to discover the legislative process, how it works, how we sponsor bills. And everything here in Guam is much the same as it is in Washington. Only here you have 15 senators. In Washington, D.C., we have 541 congresspeople and 100 senators. So when I introduce a bill in Washington, D.C., it's really quite a job to get it through, because you have to convince 500 people or 441 people to vote for your bill. So it's not so easy. And right now I've been working on three priorities. One is the war claims for the people of Guam. 5 times it has been passed by the House. But once it's passed by the House of Representatives, the congresspeople, of which I'm a member, then it has to go to the Senate. And that's where it's difficult. So I'm still at it after 9 years of working on it. And I must admit that my predecessors, Mr. Underwood and General Bloss, and also Mr. Wompat, worked on this same issue. And it's been a long time, and it's pretty frustrating. But I'm not going to give up. And then, of course, I'm working for the visa waiver for the hotel and tourism group. They want to see that happen, because then that'll bring in more tourists from both China and Russia, which the CNMI has this already. So we want it also. And it is a law. But the Department of Homeland Security is trying to develop the policies and the rules and the regulations. And so we're waiting on that. And the third is the military buildup, which everybody has heard of. And things were going very well for us, but right now there's such a problem in Washington with the budget. We have a deficit, and we're talking about cutting monies from every facet of the government. And so the military, they're looking at that as well. So that's what we're waiting on for that. But again, something will happen on Guam. I just don't know if it's going to be as big as it was previous. But believe me, I will work at that very hard, because I know this means jobs for all of you once this takes effect. In fact, all of these, especially the visa waiver too, this will mean more jobs in the tourist industry. So you're headed in the right way if you are interested in government. Now, you will also be tasked with identifying important policy issues facing Guam, just like I am facing this in Washington, D.C. So you will be getting involved. I'm sure you're all interested in what the legislature does on a day-to-day time frame. And you have to speak out. And it's not always just coming down in protests that are not, it's a friendly protest. Get your ideas across, and I think you'll go a lot further than some who come on and we have protesters in Washington, D.C. as well. So get yourself involved. I encourage you to take advantage of all the experiences and all the speakers that will talk to you in the next 3 days. And perhaps one day you'll decide that you want to pursue this career of politics. Remember, too, that all of you, no matter if you go into politics, you go into education, health, security, whatever the choice you make, you are the future leaders of Guam. You are the future leaders of Guam. Always keep that in mind. Even if you're just going to be a housewife for the girls, still, you'll take on raising your children, and they will be the next generation of leaders. So you have a very important role. And I want to talk about myself a little bit here. My husband was the politician. I wasn't. I come from a family of educators. All teachers and educators of some sort. And so when I came to Guam, and I majored in music in college. It's a far cry from where I am today. But because of my husband, I got very involved with his campaigns. I went out, I went door to door, and I helped him throughout. It was really a very hard work. But I supported him 150%. So I was out there, and all of a sudden, I did become interested in politics. So when he retired from the governorship, I took over. And then I served 5 terms as a senator, 2 terms as First Lady of Guam, and of course, 2 terms as Lieutenant Governor, and now 5 terms in the U.S. Congress. And in many of these positions, I was the first woman elected. So I've gotten to enjoy my life. I like working for the people of Guam, but like I said, my path took a different direction. I certainly never thought when I was a young person like you that I would end up in politics and a member of the United States Congress. Another valuable lesson I wish to impart is getting along together. Everybody's got a different idea about a solution to a problem. You may think it's a good idea, she may not think it's such a good idea. And right then and there you have a conflict. Well, the thing is, you've got to compromise sometimes. You have to give up some of your thoughts, and she has to give up some of her thoughts so that you can get together and make it work. Otherwise, if you're going to be in there stubborn and you're not going to change your mind, nothing will occur. And that pretty much is what's happening in Washington, D.C. right now. We have some members of Congress that are new members, and they absolutely refuse to discuss anything but their firm ideas about spending. So once you come and reach a consensus, then things will happen. And later on, down the road, if you pass this bill and it doesn't have some of your ideas in it, it doesn't have some of her ideas in it, but later on you can amend that bill as time goes on. And you see that the people of Guam really want this particular thing that you had in mind. So you could always amend it. So that's one thing, consensus, getting along together. It doesn't mean that you have to drop your ideas entirely, but maybe if you can just talk it out and say, okay, I'll accept this if you accept that. That's the best way. That's the way I work. Now, I'm a Democrat. And the Congress right now is Republican majority. The White House is Democrat. The Senate is Democrat majority. But my group that I belong to, that's where the Republicans are. But when I go to Washington, you know, I put aside the party because we only have one seat, and I have to take care of everybody that comes to me with a problem. If somebody calls me up and says, say a veteran, and I have a problem here and I'm not getting a fair treatment and all, I don't ask the person, what is your party affiliation? That's not the way to go. Right away, I tell them we're gonna look into it. We'll write to the right people to see if we can straighten this problem out. So that's the way you have to be, because once you are elected to a position, it's best to take care of all the people that need your help. But party is important because you have to run on a party label. Now, another thing I want to bring up is that when you do come to a consensus, that's what the Chamorros are all about. We're a friendly, hospitable people. I bring many congresspeople out to Guam. In the last 5 or 9 years, I think I brought close to 100 members of Congress, and they always come back and say, Madeline, that island is so beautiful. The people are so friendly. And of course, they say other things like our food is so great too. But always let's keep up that Chamorro spirit. That's what I learned when I grew up in Guam. And I think this will work for you throughout your life. I congratulate and I commend all of you for being interested in this kind of a career. And your desire to contribute to the island. And you know, another thing is, you don't necessarily have to run for senator or mayor or governor or whatever. You can be members of nonprofit organizations. For 27 years, that's what I did. I belonged to every club and organization on Guam. Some of them I founded. I worked with the Guam Litigo and Bodic Association. I worked with the Guam Symphony Society, the Guam Women's Club, the Guam Council of Women's Clubs. You name it, I was a member. My husband used to say, my wife, she's out every day to some kind of a meeting. But I always wanted to help out. If I was in a position to help out, I did it. So I want to thank you again for allowing me to speak today. I am here in Guam for 10 days, and then I have to go back to Washington because we're going to decide on this budget process. It's being worked on now, and I hope everything comes out well. And I also know that you're going to find this conference very, very interesting. So keep up the good work. And for those that haven't been to Washington, sign up in your school and come and visit us. Because you'll find that our office is very hospitable and we do have a lot of fun in Washington, along with a lot of good hard work. So again, thank you, and sijus masi. Nice weather then too. Yeah. Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you very much. I just wanted to mention that the Congresswoman, her staff, has been really helpful in Washington. We met with Congresswoman Guåhan's staff. and they were able to give us a lot of help in knowing where to look up issues and what kinds of things are going on in Guam. And so we really appreciate you guys. Thank you very much, both of you. It's great. Okay. Okay, so we'll keep going with the legislative process. Yeah, you've got it right. So, yes, teacher organizations, educators, a really important group. It comes together because they have a shared interest and they present ideas. They also keep an eye on what's going on in the legislature. And as bills are underway, they keep paying attention and they interact. Make sure that the laws are helpful to teachers and to education in general. Any other ideas about who might form a group of some sort or another as ordinary citizens? Yes, sir.
Hi, my name is Roscoe. I'm from Jonathan.
Nice job, Roscoe. Perfect example. Veterans organizations are very important avenues of getting ideas into Congress and also staying informed about the issues that affect veterans and trying to persuade legislators. Okay, so the whole idea here is this is one of the ways that citizens have input into the process by the generation of ideas. And as we said, it's sometimes individual citizens saying, I've got an idea. More often than not, it's groups of ordinary citizens who have shared some sort of common interest. Important to keep in mind, Congresswoman Bordello said that she hopes that some of you may go into politics, but she also said that all of you, whether you go into politics, maintain an interest in politics. Remember, Dr. King, for instance. Dr. King a politician? No, was he involved in politics? You bet. And so, there.
Wasn't elected.
Was not an elected official. He was an organizer of community interest on a particular set of subjects. And this is the idea of what we are doing this week, is getting you used to working in an organized fashion with others to play a role in informing the lawmakers about what your ideas are and what you believe should be done in law. So, as we already said, though you can have an idea and propose an idea, what are some other places ideas come from? We are citizens, individual citizens, groups of citizens. What are some of the other places that ideas come from? Don't overthink it. Sure, just the country's overall view. Although the media doesn't, directly call up and say, hey, we've got an idea. There are media organizations that do that. But the media in the news and stuff, they put the news on, and of course that creates a sort of general sense of things that need to be addressed by legislators. Other places where ideas come from. How about legislators? Right? Obviously, one of the most common sources of ideas for legislation comes from legislators. That's why you elect them. And a lot of times those ideas are generated during campaign. Legislators tend to think a lot about the issues that the people have on their mind when they're getting to run for office or run for re-election. And a lot of times that's when they will say, if you elect me, I will do the following things. I will propose these laws. I'll do these that. And then they go into the next session of Congress, and sure enough, they try to get those things done. One other important source of ideas for law. Other important branch of government. Judicial branch doesn't often second, which is? Okay, at the federal level, it's the president. At the state level, it is? The governor. Who is? And as I said, and that is a fairly, you heard President Obama get on TV and say, pass this law. And he was talking about the jobs law, right? So he had an idea. But President Obama cannot go to Congress and say, I wrote up a bill, here it is, it's bill number 1026, go to work. He can't do that. He's a president of the United States, and he still can't go to the legislature and put a bill into the process. You've got to call up a congressman, and you've got to say, would you please take my idea and put it into the formal bill language and put it into the system? He can put it into the formal language himself. But you still have to get a congressman to do the proposal. And that's important to know because that's about the separation of government. We do not live in a kingdom. We don't live in a dictatorship. Even though the president has a lot of power, even though the governor has a lot of power, they don't have all the power. They still have to respect that legislative process. So a bill is assigned, and then it's put to committee. And this is the same federal level as it is here. Just as you guys are going to separate yourselves into little issue, you're going to separate yourselves into issue areas so that you can concentrate and focus on specific things and not have to think about everything all at once. And you can get expertise on a certain narrow range of issues. The same thing happens in the legislature. They break their 15 members up into committees with special attention on different areas of policy and issue topics. And so when a bill is proposed, they have to figure out, okay, does this, which committee should this go to? Which one is going to have jurisdiction over this issue? And some bills, especially like budget bills, have to go through a couple of different committees because they touch on a number of different issues. A really important part of this process is the public hearing where the public has an opportunity to come, hear the debate, but also to give their own, express their own ideas about bills that are being considered and are underway. And in Guam, by law, even after the public hearing is held, there's an extended period of time, and I can't remember how long is it?
10 days.
There's 10 days after the public hearing where you can still comment on legislation underway. Some of this stuff is fairly technical. The bill goes to the Senate. The committees have a job. The job of the committee is to formalize the idea of the original bill. They look over the bill and they go through a process very similar to the kind of process you're going to go through where they do research and they try to figure out, okay, what are the implications of this bill? What are the impacts going to be? There's actually a copy of a bill from last session in your packet. 7. This is the one that's about lowering the legal drinking age. Did not pass. But you'll see that section 1 is legislative finding and intent. A lot of times this is where the committee puts the outcome of the research that it's done on about the bill, about the idea of the bill. Okay? And then the committee has some choices to make. The committee can amend the bill. They can send the bill just exactly the way it is. Or they can essentially let the bill die somewhere in committee. In Congress, and I would be willing to bet the same thing in the Guam legislature, that the most common thing that happens to bills is somewhere in that committee process, they just die. In the U.S. Congress,
that we are, yes.
Why did what change?
It didn't. That bill did not pass. Oh, why did it go back up? I don't want to take a lot of time to get sidetracked, but I will answer your question, mostly because of federal highway funding. In order to qualify for federal highway funding, and this isn't just one, this is all 50 states and the territories, if you are going to get federal highway funds, Congress has said you must have a 21-year drinking age. If you lower it below 21, you go ahead. You're a state. You can do what you want. Huh? Not just to fix roads, to maintain roads, to keep roads, to have roads. Without highway funds, you would not like driving in Guåhan. Hard enough, isn't it? I know. You can drove around. No state wants to lose its federal highway fund. Trust me. Okay. Back on track. So the committee, oftentimes, we are in four digits right now in the U.S. Congress. I forget what the bill numbers are up to now. But they're well over 1,000. And they start literally at 001. So that tells you there's been over 1,000 bills in this session of Congress that have been proposed. Out of that, maybe, well, including the minor stuff that makes it in the bill, and just pass appropriately. So we go, everybody agree, sure, why not? Only a few hundred ever see the final end of the process where we get a vote on whether or not they're actually going to get sent to the president for a signature. A small, small percentage. And so most of them die somewhere in that committee process. Keep that in mind, because you're going to have a lot of ideas as you start, and then you're going to narrow down in your committees to things that you're actually going to push further on. And that's exactly what Congress does, and your legislature. And then there comes a point when there's debate by the whole body in the Senate, and the Senate can amend during that process. And then they ultimately have to take a final vote. And in the third vote, the final vote, when that gets filed, they were done amending. We're done debating. We've done voting. It's up or down. And then, so that, let's say, they made it through that whole process. There are 15 legislators, 15 senators. How many have to say aye in order for a bill to pass? What? And so that's it. So eight members said yes. The committee said yes. Got all the way through. Eight members said aye. Is it a law?
No.
No. What? Yes. Oh, you made the governor very angry. The governor said, hey, wait a minute. Yeah, I got a role to play here. No, it's not a law. The governor has to sign, right?
Yes.
If the governor says, no, I veto this bill, is that it? Is it done? Is it dead?
No. No. It goes back.
It can go back to Congress. It can. Congress decides whether they're going to do it or not. And what's that? So what can the Congress do? They could go back through the process and just try again with something that they think with the governor would agree to. What else could they do?
Failed override.
What was it? Budget bill?
Yeah. So they tried to override, but they couldn't get two-thirds, so it failed, so the veto stayed. Okay, and that's the process. So in that process, where are the places where citizens can have an influence on the direction of law? This is a review, and we already said it, so it's just a matter of remembering what that said.
Hi, my name is Charlie. I'm a member of the high school. I think you have to say in what the government is doing during the public hearing.
Public hearing is an ideal place for citizens to have input into the process. In fact, this is sort of key. This is why when you hear there's a public hearing, your website, by the way, the Guam Legislature website, is, I'm not kidding, one of the best websites I have seen of all the 50 states and the territories. This website is really user-friendly for ordinary, non-elected people to find out what is going on. It's fantastic. And you should all be very happy and proud to know that your legislators are trying really hard to make it easy for ordinary citizens to know what's going on. So it's easy to find out what bills have been proposed. It's easy, and you will go through it. It's in your notebook. And we're going to go through it when it matters. We actually need to know it. You can find out what bills have been proposed, where they are in this legislative process, and know exactly when a public hearing is going to happen on it, so that you can be there. So it's real simple to find out if there's something going on that you're really interested in, or you think is really important, and you've got something you want to say. It is easy in Guam to do that. Okay, so that's the legislative process. Two things of note. Oh, the other place is obvious. It's in the idea generation part of it, where you have the opportunity to tell members to come out and say, got an idea for the individual or the organization. An important note here is about what we mean when we say law. Oftentimes when we say, make a law to deal with an issue, a lot of times think of laws like don't spit on the sidewalk, don't drive faster than 35 miles an hour, keep your dog on a leash, there's a fine if you don't do those things, maybe a jail sentence if you're really serious, and that's what they think of when they think of making law. But remember, anytime the legislature wants to do anything, if they want to start a program to take care of children whose parents have abandoned them or something, if they want a program to do that, they have to make a law that puts that program in place, right? It's a law. If they want to spend money to, they already have a law that says you can't spit on the sidewalk. Nobody knows about it, and they're all spitting on the sidewalk anyway. So now they think, okay, we gotta have some sort of public awareness campaign to make people aware that it's a law you can't spit on the sidewalk. Well, if they wanna have a public awareness campaign, they have to make a law to spend the money to do that. So when you look up the public law in Guam, you're not only looking up the code of things you can do, things you can't do, things you must do, you're also looking up things the government spends money on, programs that the government has decided to put in place. Every department of the executive branch of government is established under the public law. So everything makes its way into lawmaking through the legislative process. Okay? about this right now. So do you, you can get your brains warming up on issues. We're going to do a couple of really simple things and start with the simplest of all. On page 2, up at the top is a little bank of ideal work. These are not intended to be pick one. These are intended to be generating your thoughts about some of the issues you may be concerned about and want. So look over that issue then, okay? And then there's a place where it says my top three issues. At the territorial level, and you don't, again, don't necessarily stick with what's up here. It's on your experience. Top three things you're concerned about at the territory, at the state level, one. Three things that you're concerned about at the national, federal level, and those may be some of the same things. And perhaps three things that you are worried about or concerned about or you think that are issues of importance globally. So just write down three things here, three things here, three things here. Okay, the next step is going to be where we start sharing these ideas. John's going to walk you through this process.
All right, so,
yeah.
Yeah, this is just a directive for yourself. This is not, this whole tactic is not something you turn in. This is all.
This is for you. These are our tools.
Paul and I don't grade anything. We might give you home. What did you call it last week? Home opportunity.
Yes, we don't have home.
We don't have home
opportunity.
Opportunity. For you to expand your mind. Feel pretty good. thing you should do, it should be obvious, is if you're around new people, you should introduce yourself. This is probably all the other stuff. All right. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 1, 2, 3, 4.
Remember your number as John gives it to you.
Okay, ladies and gentlemen, this process is called brainstorming. When you are brainstorming, you are just writing up your ideas as quickly as they come. Don't criticize. Don't try to get it perfect. You're just throwing out raw ideas. Okay, at this point, take your marker with you and stay in your group and move one area to your left. This group comes up here. That group back there goes over to this wall over here. Everybody else, just move left. Oh. Okay. When you are in your new group, I mean, at your new station, I should say, before you start writing, take a moment to read what the group before you put up. So look over the thoughts of your previous colleagues and then start adding your own new ideas. If you see an idea up that you like, just put a check mark next to it. If you see something that could be improved by adding to it, just add to it. Another 10 seconds. $200 for something that was sitting right here. Okay, ready? You're going to move one to the left. Once again, read through what the previous groups have had to say. If you see something you like, put a check mark next to it. If you don't see something that you think should be there, add it. If you see something that's a start of a good idea, but you want to add more to it, add more to it. Take your marker with you and move one station to your left. Not yet. Look it over. See what's already written there. Put a check mark next to things you agree with. Add things you don't see.
Yeah. By the way, I was one of the chaperones that took Laurie Spishel on that 92 trip.
Oh, really?
That was on JFK. He's one of my students. Yeah. And I was telling the speaker, I'm also a fellow youth congress speaker. I was the first high school student speaker, the first female speaker.
Oh, wow.
It's very, I like to, this is, I mean, it's like taking three strands of hair and braiding it into one thing, our legislature, the youth, and close up.
Okay, ladies and gentlemen, one station to your left. Take your markers with you and move one station to your left. Remember, this is brainstorming, this is not your final product at all. We've got days to go. Ten more seconds. And one more to your left. Please take your marker with you. No. You have to see them all before you decide other. You have to see them all before you decide something's other. Okay, at this point, you have seen all six issues. Topic areas. Only a few of you at a time. If you have an issue concern that is not under any one of these six categories, you can come up and write it under other, but only a few of you at a time. Don't everybody gather up here. And as soon as you're done writing your other, go back to the group you're in right now. Okay, stay in your groups, but I need your attention for a second. Does anybody have any other issue not covered in one of those six areas? Okay. All right. So, okay. Anybody else? It's brainstorming. Just write it up, whatever you got. Anyone else with an other? Okay, as soon as you guys are done writing it, go back to the group you were in. Okay. Oh, got one more. Okay. All right. Well, got another one.
Thank you. We'll mull this one over.
We'll mull this one over and make sure it gets them. Federal funding for public schools sounds like an education. And maybe an economic. More youth involvement in politics. Well, that's why we're all here. We'll say that's more the cultural and an education. What's the Jones Act?
First and last, legibly.
And please write so we can use what they said. And if on that side, indicate whether you have a laptop that you'll be bringing with you or you don't. If you have one, write laptop. If you don't have one, don't write anything at all. Just write laptop if you have one. On the line side, in order, in your notebook, it has, on page 3, it has the name of each of the 6 issue committees. Okay? They're right there. They include issue areas in the notebook. Underneath each title of the committee are some bullet points. I want you to know that those bullet points were really put in there so that John and I, when we did research, we can organize our research. You are not restricted in the committee that you sit, that you join. You're not restricted to these bullet point issues. You don't have to do any one of them. You can do some things that are outside of them, or you can do them as a man. You're going to decide for yourself in the industry. Again, the bullet points are there to give you an idea of the research that we pulled together so we have some material we can look at. So take a minute and think about your top choice, your second choice, and your third choice, and on the line side, label it clearly, 1, 2, 3. Number 1, the first choice of which committee you would like to be in, second choice, and your third choice. John and I are going to take those cards, and we're going to sit down and try really hard to give everybody their first choice. When we were given this just last week, the CMI, we were able to give
Yes, ma'am. Exactly. One of the reasons is that you're going to end up all just sort of throwing the same ideas together all on the same level because we're all studying the same thing. What's another reason? Organizing. You cannot use the power of numbers to influence.
you're picking your top three committees. So either the Committee on Education or the Committee on Law Enforcement or the Committee on Cultural Affairs. Pick your top three committees.